From the heart of our nation's capital, here's Family Research Council President Tony Perkins.
Well, hello everyone, and welcome to Washington Watch. Coming up, if the opening prayer of the 117th Congress is any indication, we're in for a bizarre 2 years.
Now and evermore, we ask it in the name of the monotheistic God, Brahma, and God known by many names, by many different faiths. A man and a woman.
That was Congressman Emmanuel Cleaver, a Methodist minister, opening yesterday's session in the House with prayer. We'll talk about it a little later with Texas Congressman Louie Gohmert. We will also discuss his lawsuit that sought to give Vice President Pence the ability to reject disputed slates of electors. And speaking of elections, was it stolen in broad daylight? Phil Klein, former Attorney General of Kansas and director of Thomas More Society's Amistad Project, has been briefing lawmakers on how executive officials in swing states facilitated manipulation of the election outcome through novel contracts and data sharing with these private groups. Phil is here with more later on Washington Watch. And while a lot of attention is focused on Wednesday's joint session of Congress to certify the presidential election, there is an equal amount of attention focused on the state of Georgia with its unprecedented runoff election for two Senate seats that will determine control of the U.S. Senate. Tennessee Senator Marsha Blackburn has been in the Peach State campaigning for Senators Loeffler and Perdue, and she'll join us in just a moment with an update on this critical election. Also, FRC Action has been on the ground in Georgia over the holidays, knocking on doors to help turn out conservative voters for tomorrow's election. FRC Action's political engagement manager will join us live from Georgia with an update on what the team has been doing. The website, TonyPerkins.com. If you're on Twitter, it is at T Perkins. And by the way, I want to thank all of those who helped us at the year end to reach our goal, being prepared financially to meet the challenges of this coming year. So thanks so much for being a part of that. And I know I don't need to say this, but I know we have a lot of listeners in Georgia, and I know you don't need a reminder, but let me remind you, if you haven't voted already, early voted, make sure you plan now to vote in tomorrow's election. The control of the U.S. Senate will be determined by this unprecedented election in Georgia tomorrow, where not one but both of the state's Senate seats will be decided by voters. So far, over 3 million voters have gone to the polls, early voting, absentee balloting, they voted, but that's about 1 million lower than in the November election. So that means turnout tomorrow could make the difference in the election outcome. Here to talk about the contrast in candidates and what is to be determined by tomorrow's election outcome is Tennessee Senator Marsha Blackburn. Marsha, welcome back to the program. Thanks so much for being with us.
Good to be with you. And yes, tomorrow is a big day, and Wednesday is going to be a big day also.
Well, I want to talk about both. First, you've been in Georgia taking time away to campaign during the holidays for Senator Loeffler and Perdue. Why? What's at stake in this election?
Oh, it is control of the Senate. And Chuck Schumer defined it very well himself. He said, first, we're going to go take Georgia. Not we're going to win it. Not we're going to fight for every vote. But we're going to go take it. And then we're going to change America. And that has been his approach to this entire thing. They want to institute their socialist agenda with statehood for D.C. and for Puerto Rico, allowing felons to vote, making certain that they repeal the Trump tax cuts, being certain that they implement the Green New Deal, and that they push a government-run health care Medicaid for all type program. And guess what? They're going to do that in the first 100 days. So this is the firewall. I tell people in Georgia, look, it's pretty simple. 5 phone calls a day helps keep the liberals away, because you need to be getting your friends and neighbors out to vote. And that is how this is going to be won in Georgia. So vital for everybody to go vote tomorrow and to call their friends and get them to the polls.
Now, that's quite a list of things that are on their to-do list of what they want to accomplish if they have the majority of the Senate. But I'll have to say, you're just scratching the surface with that list. There are so much they want to do. Undo all of President Trump's accomplishments. They have in their crosshairs the Hyde Amendment, which is the prohibition against taxpayer funding to fund elective abortions, which is something you have fought for to uphold the sanctity of human life. That's at stake in this. Our military, national defense is at stake. So much is at stake. What was your sense? And I've been to Georgia actually two or three times in the last month myself. But what was your take as you interacted with voters there in Georgia?
You know, one of the things that really surprised me was that Georgia voters were astounded that that you have these two leftist radicals, a socialist who is a trust fund guy. You have a radical leftist who will not denounce Marxism and Raphael Warnock, and that they are the Democrat Party nominees. And Georgians are surprised that they're the nominees. They're surprised that people from outside of Georgia have been able to vote in their election. And they really can't understand why their state legislators and the Secretary of State have not cleaned this up.
Yes, the same thing that I heard. Of course, when you look at Atlanta, about 4 million people there, they have a oversized influence on the state when it comes to elections. We had a similar situation for years in Louisiana, where I'm from, with New Orleans being a quarter of the state's voters. Of course, Hurricane Katrina kind of changed that situation. But there are rural voters in northern Georgia, which we've, looking at the numbers, they have not voted early. Now, that leads me to believe one of two things. Either they're completely frustrated with the alleged the fraud and irregularities that we've seen, or they're waiting to make sure that their vote counts by voting in person. I hope it's the latter.
I am also hopeful it's the latter, and it's why President Trump is going into Dalton, Georgia, in order to make certain that those North Georgia voters get to the polls. If you want to protect President Trump's legacy, if you want to make certain that we keep these judges on the federal bench and that we do not expand the Supreme Court, if you want to make certain that we stop socialism every time they try to push forward on it, it is imperative that everyone go vote.
Yeah, you pointed to this, but increasingly the stark contrast between candidates that we have the choice between is just so bright. I mean, there's such a clear contrast in Georgia that voters have tomorrow when they go to the polls. And again, as you've pointed out, what's at stake here is control of the United States Senate. And if the Democrats gain the control of the Senate, they will have – they'll be able to run the table on the federal government with the presidency, the House, and all of those things you listed plus more will be accomplished, as you said, very rapidly. You know, I remember having this conversation, Senator Blackburn, with a Blue Dog Democrat. That's they're no longer they're extinct.
They're
we don't
extinct.
See them anymore. But there was one that I was having dinner with in 2009 before the Obamacare was forced through Congress, knowing all the polling said, you know what, this is going to cost them the majority. And I remember having dinner with this Democratic member, and I said, doesn't Nancy Pelosi realize this is going to cost her the majority and the Democrats are going to lose the majority by pushing this through? He didn't miss a beat. He said, oh, they know that, but they know they'll fundamentally change the country and the Republicans will never undo it. And I hate to say it, but here we are, 2020, still have Obamacare.
Right.
They don't mind using their majority to accomplish their agenda. So this is not rhetoric. This is something they will do if they have the ability to do it.
You're exactly right. And they are planning to push as hard as they can. And this is why they have put all of these tens of millions of dollars, hundreds of millions of dollars into Georgia and trying to win this race. because they want to fundamentally change this country and put us on a fast track to socialism.
Yes, absolutely. But the good news here is, Senator Blackburn, dollars don't vote, people do. And if you're in Georgia, you need to vote tomorrow. Vote your values. Now, we've got a few minutes left. Senator Blackburn, I want to transition to another issue. You made reference to big day here in Washington, D.C. on Wednesday when Congress meets to receive the Electoral College votes. And you have joined with your colleagues in the Senate, led by Senator Cruz, calling for an audit of some of these states in question. Explain that to our listeners.
Oh, I'll be happy to. And yes, some of us had been working separately for a couple of weeks on how we best approach dealing with these disputed states and their vote totals. And of course, hearing from people in the states about their concern with some of these non-elected officials who took it upon themselves to change the way mail-out ballots were done, to change the way signature verification and authentication was done. So we started comparing notes. We pulled all of our ideas together and said, you know, using the model of 1877, where they met, put a commission together of five members of each of the House, the Senate, and the Supreme Court, and took a period of time. We designated 10 days, conduct a review, bring it back to us so that the American people know they have an answer on what happened in the 2020 election. And Tony, one of the reasons this is so important is look at what the Democrats did with the 2016 election.
Mm-hmm.
They never accepted the results. They said they were the resistance. They were going to obstruct and fight Donald Trump every day. They said he was an illegitimate president. The elections were illegitimate. So if you want to bring a conclusion to this, if you want to be able to define what happened, you don't just say, here's the problem. You say, here's the problem, and here is an action that will lead us to a solution. So let's do this. Let's halt. Let's have this review, and then let's reconvene ourselves, hear the results, and cast our vote.
So this could, if this is accepted, could this delay the confirmation of the Electoral College report to Congress?
It would put it 10 days. It would put it on the 16th of January.
Okay.
They would have 10 days to do their work.
You know, I think this is very prudent because what happens without this is that the American people will lack confidence in our system, whether it's in 2020 or 2024.
That's right. And we have the best system on the face of the earth, and we want to protect it.
Senator Marsha Blackburn, as always, great to have you on the program and grateful for your leadership.
You.